So welcome to a different kind of mythology video. Now, all my students and you need to know that I have a bit of a cube fetish. So mathematical cubes, Rubik's cubes, anything goes. So what I want to do today is introduce you to some fairly recently discovered mind-boggling facts about cubes that hardly anybody knows about, not even mathematicians. All right, so I've got two warm-up exercises for you. The first one concerns this. What is this? Well, it definitely looks like a cube, right? Well, if you're a cuber, you say, no, it's not a cube, it's a twisty puzzle, it's a Skewb. So it's a cube-shaped twisty puzzle. Well, and you're right, it's a twisty puzzle, but it's not cube-shaped. Let me just have a peel it off the table here and show it to you. There you see it's not a cube, it's actually, the shape here is a rhombic dodecahedron. So it's 12 rhombuses, very symmetric, really nice thing. We'll need it for later, so keep that one in mind. So I've got a second warm-up exercise, and the second warm-up exercise is, what is that? Well, it definitely looks like a circle, right? But it actually, it's not a circle, no. It's a 2D shadow of a 666-dimensional cube. Well, those warm-up exercises were just to whet your appetite. Now, let's get into it. All right, so the plan is to get this video done in two parts. In the first part, I'll introduce you to the basic facts. Pretty much anybody can appreciate these, I think, and enjoy them. And in the second part, I drill much deeper mathematically, as usual. All right, so our story begins in 1985. In 1985, mathematician Peter McMullen discovered a fact about the cube that nobody had seen before, as far as I know. All right, so imagine a cube like this hovering in midair with the sun right above casting a shadow on the ground, okay? Well, I've got a bit of an animation here for you. All right, so what we're going to do is we're going to measure the area of the shadow, okay? And the other thing we're going to do is we're going to measure the difference in height between the topmost point of the cube and the bottommost point of the cube. As I rotate the cube, the shape of the shadow will change, and so will these two numbers, all right? Okay, now for the really, really amazing bit, let's adjust the side lengths of our cube to be exactly one. Then the number measuring the area of the shadow and the number measuring the height difference will become exactly equal. And this is not a coincidence. As long as we are dealing with a unit cube, this will always be the case, no matter how the cube is oriented in space and what shape the shadow pans out to be. Now, people often get confused by this unit cube business. So let me say a little bit more about this, okay? So usually we measure, say, in meters, distance. And then, well, if it's meters in distance, we usually use meters squared for areas. So let's just do that. So now, if you've got a cube that side lengths 1 meter, then all this will work out. The shadow theorem will guarantee that the two numbers we're measuring are going to be exactly the same. Now, if you're measuring in meters, but you use a cube that has side lengths 2 meters, this will no longer work. And it's also pretty obvious. If it works for 1 meter, because distances and areas scale in different ways, it will definitely never work for anything else. So very cute property, but is it useful? Well, yes. So for example, if we want to figure out what the smallest possible shadow is, or what the largest possible shadow is, because those two numbers are the same, the only thing we have to figure out is what's the smallest possible height difference and what's the largest possible height difference. Well, smallest possible height difference we definitely get when we orient the cube like this, just parallel to the ground, right? Then the height difference is just that. You can't get any smaller than this, obviously. What's the shadow? Well, the shadow is just a copy of this square face. All right, what about the largest possible shadow? For that, we have to arrange the cube in space so that we get maximal distance, and obviously that's the case when we've got one corner right above the other one like this. And when you do the calculations, or when you do the experiment, you actually find that the shadow then is a perfect regular hexagon, which is also pretty neat. So what I've drawn here is the smallest possible shadow and the largest possible shadow, and you can actually see that the smallest shadow fits inside the largest one. And that suggests something really cute. What you do is you take a cube like this and drill a hole through it with this square as cross section. Okay, I've actually not done this, but I've done a 3D printed version of this. So here are two cubes of exactly the same size, and one features one of those sort of square hole. So I'll just take it out here. And now what I can do is something amazing. I can actually pass the second cube through the hole like so. Very neat, right? So I can actually pass a cube through itself. And you can actually do even better. You can see I can make this square hole even bigger, and then I can pass an even larger cube through this hole. Now, the first to notice that something like this is possible is or was Prince Rupert, who lived in the 17th century. And he was a general, so basically in the business of killing people, but he was also quite interested in science. And if you are like quite active on YouTube, I'm pretty sure you've come across some videos about the Prince Rupert drop. Not the Prince Rupert cube, but the Prince Rupert drop. And that's, well, you just melt a bit of glass and then you pour it into a bucket of cold water, and then you get these strange glass tadpoles, which have this amazing property that if you hit the front part with a hammer, they won't shatter like anybody would expect. But if you just snip the tail off a little bit, the whole thing will explode and basically turn into dust. Really amazing, especially if it's captured on slow-mo video. And a couple of people have done this. For example, here's a screenshot from a video by Smarter Every Day. So you can really see this thing exploding. It's amazing. So check out these videos. All right, and this is the end of part one. In part two, we'll go a lot deeper maths-wise. So, you know, if you're up for it, check out part two.